tonight. Council and mayor are putting together a task force to tackle local crime. Plus, the province is looking into ways to address the ongoing issues of weapons and drugs in BC hospitals. And BC's credit rating has been downgraded. We get local reaction and what it means for the economy.
Good evening, I'm Eddie Huband and welcome to CKPG News. Our top story tonight, there was a heavy RCMP presence at the 800 block of Tabor Boulevard earlier today. Mounties state that they received reports of a disturbance at 11:15 a.m. and promptly arrived on scene. Police received reports that a resident of an apartment on Tabor discharged bear spray. Upon arrival, the complainant said the suspect had a firearm as well. Due to this, police evacuated the building and called in emergency response crews, the dog service teams, and frontline officers. But the suspect has fled from the scene and is still at large.
We were contacted initially because bear spray had been deployed in the building. And then there was a report of a weapon being produced and some of the residents of the building threatened. So police went out there. We did ask the building tenants to evacuate the residents in the building. And as well, we did contact local school administration and let them know of our presence in the area and that it was a weapons complaint and asked them to follow their policies. So once we gained entry into the apartment where this took place, the suspect had fled. So the suspect is still outstanding. However, we believe this to be a targeted attack and there's no risk to the general public.
Prince George Fire Rescue responded to a structure fire on the 100 block of Fern Crescent this morning. Crews from three halls responded at approximately 9:30 a.m. to find heavy smoke and flames coming from the roof on the backside of the home. Crews were able to quickly contain the fire in the attic, and Prince George Fire Rescue estimates the damages at $100,000. The cause of the fire is under investigation, and there were no injuries. And a separate large fire broke out downtown earlier this morning as well. At around 4 a.m. in the 1300 block of Fifth Avenue, firefighters responded to a commercial fire in an alleyway. A multi-unit commercial railway was found with smoke and fire coming from it, and it took 4 hours to contain the event and to eventually put out the fire. Damages are estimated at $150,000. Luckily, no one was injured, and the cause of this fire is also under investigation. Lots of fire talk today as the BC Wildfire Service has come out with a reminder of the current burning ban. In late March, the BC Wildfire Service introduced the first burning ban for Category 2 and 3 fires, but there have been some breaches of that ban. And given the nature of the drought conditions in the area, the fire center, it's concerning for them.
So right now we just have 6 active wildfires in the fire center, but we do have some holdover fires from the last season. So again, like the holdover fires would be like something that was just burning deep into the ground and just carried over throughout the winter into our spring season here. We would just like to remind the public about the Category 2 and 3 bans that are put in place, and also for the public just to be vigilant and ensure any pre-existing piles are fully extinguished and not to light any new piles just with the drought conditions in place.
In civic news, crime in the downtown area of Prince George has been a conversation of discussion around council chambers for years, starting with a mass public meeting way back in December of 2019. And at last night's meeting, two endeavors were put forward to look at dealing with the issue. Cheryl Jan has the story.
Council has approved the creation of a standing committee on public safety, and so far its composition is made up of the mayor and councillors Brian Skaken, Trudy Clausen and Ron Palula. 3 members of the community will also be appointed.
Today I will be sending 3-4 invitation letters to the people that I think it will be most relevant to this file, and to see if they'd be willing to sit on it with us. And we will starting to do the work right away.
By the work, what Mayor Simon Yu references is the gathering of crime stats and comparing best practices with other jurisdictions specific to crime in the downtown.
The bottom line is, 37% of our budget going to, public safety. We need to find a way to do better. And also, the citizens, they don't feel safe in some part of the downtown, as well as Miller Edition. People really feel the pressure
On a related note, Councillor Kyle Sampson, supported by Councillors Tim Bennett and Corey Ramsey, put forward a notice of motion calling for a community safety town hall meeting.
The city has absolutely been looking at the slate of issues, primarily, you know, homelessness, addiction issues, mental health issues, and we've been advocating heavily for resources to support those experiencing those things. But what we haven't been as great at in the last year and a half, has been really touching base with the broader community and better understanding where the rest of our community's at, where everybody's at.
Councillor Sampson has been the loudest around chambers as to how mental health, addictions, and homelessness are not the jurisdiction of the city.
This is a provincial issue. This is within the provincial government's jurisdiction. However, Prince George is our community, and we're responsible for things like public safety. There's only so far a municipality can take that before it bumps into the provincial government's jurisdiction. But I want to help bring resolve to some of the issues that people are experiencing day to day within our abilities, within our jurisdiction. And beyond that jurisdiction, I want to take those issues up the chain.
That notice of motion will be hashed out at the next council meeting. Cheryl Jan, CKPG News.
In a broader sense, in a bid to address drug use and weapons in BC hospitals, the provincial government will be setting up a new task force to streamline policies so that health authorities in the province will all have the same rules. Adam Burles has this story.
We have to take very specific steps to ensure that everywhere, regardless of whether it's St. Paul's, regardless of whether it's Baker, regardless of whether it is Prince Rupert, regardless of whether it's Dawson Creek, that everywhere, Honourable Speaker, the same policies apply and are seen to apply.
That was Minister of Health Adrian Dix in the House on Monday, saying that the province would be reviewing policies to address drug use and weapons in BC hospitals. The minister said that a new task force would be created to streamline policies so that all health authorities across the province will have the same rules.
There are some differences between the policies in different health authorities, and that's why put in place a task force to ensure that we have one policy across BC with respect to issues of people using illicit drugs in hospitals.
BC United Health critic Shirley Bond says that the decision to create a task force is disappointing.
It comes up far short of what nurses should be expecting from this government. The best the minister and premier can do is come up with a task force. These issues are happening every single day. It's certainly not going to help in the short term, and I'm not sure that it will have much value at all.
Bond also called the decision to create a task force reactionary, but admitted that the discussion that will take place with the task force will be important.
My concern is this was a knee-jerk reaction to pressure that has been building. And while that discussion that takes place at the task force will be important, what I care about most is what's going to happen tomorrow.
So if a task force isn't the solution, what is BC United's solution?
There needs to be standards of care. There needs to be a consistent approach to how we help people who are struggling with mental health and addictions issues. But at the same time, we need to make sure that patients in British Columbia feel safe in hospitals. And most importantly, that healthcare professionals can go to work every day.
The government says that more details regarding the task force will be provided at a later date, including who will be on it and what their responsibilities will be. Adam Burles, CKPG News.
More political news now. BC's Green Party leader says the new measures taken by the NDP government to support seniors is a step in the right direction, but still doesn't resolve ongoing concerns. The province is granting a one-time $430 benefit to about 20,000 seniors in its support program for elderly low-income renters. Sonia Firstino says the changes rely on a one-time benefit, which she calls short-sighted, noting that the former seniors advocate had called for higher consistent funding for those seniors. Firstino says the money fails to address the systemic issues, leaving seniors to continually choose between essentials like medication, food, or heating. Pilots at WestJet Encore have approved an agreement in principle with the airline's executive after 7 months of negotiations and avoiding strike action. Last week, WestJet Encore pilots voted overwhelmingly in favor of strike action, with wages being a major sticking point in the negotiations. The Airline Pilots Association says that while contract language still needs to be finalized, both sides have come to an agreement on most of the terms and conditions. The ALPA says that this agreement goes a long way in bringing Encore pilots in line with regional counterparts. Areas that would have been affected by the strike would have included Prince George, but YXS was prepared for any eventuality.
We're closely monitoring that situation. As you know, it's part of a process that contract negotiations often take. However, we feel they'll be able to work something out, but we are planning.
A record $7.9 billion budget deficit in the 2024 provincial budget has played a role in the province's credit rating to drop, leaving some concern that government spending is out of control. Tommy Osborne has the story.
The 2024 provincial budget is once again forecasting a deficit, which would have the province's total debt climb by nearly $20 billion to a total of $123.2 billion of debt. Because of this, S&P Global, a credit rating agency, has downgraded the province's credit rating ranking, which has the Canadian Taxpayers Federation concerned.
There's absolutely no reason why BC should be in this economic position. We've got a wealth of natural resources. We've got a whole bunch of really skilled and talented people who can make our economy thrive. But a series of really bad decisions from this current government has led to yet another credit rating downgrade.
A lower credit rating means interest rates will rise for the province, and Binda says this will hit taxpayers' wallets hard.
We're going to be spending about $4.1 billion just on the interest payments for that debt this year alone.
In a written statement, Finance Minister Katrine Conroy said the public expects the government to support them during difficult times. So cutting funds to things like hospitals or schools would only make life harder and is the wrong move. And she added that while, yes, there has been a drop in the credit rating, if you take a look at all four credit rating agencies, BC still ranks among the province's top. And we also rank close to the top as far as creating better wages, creating jobs, low unemployment rate, and one of the lowest GDP to debt ratios. But not everyone remains convinced.
I mean, these guys are driving this province over a cliff. And as the old saying goes about debt, debt is never a problem until it is. And then once it is the only problem.
Both Rustad and Binda know that money has to be spent to support communities, but they have concerns on how the government is doing its spending.
Between 2016 and 2023, the government's core bureaucracy grew by about 31%. That's not folks like bus drivers, teachers, police officers, nurses. That's bureaucratic staffers in the ministry.
While the credit rating did drop, S&P added in its report that it expects things to improve in 2025, largely due to the LNG sector and more activity in our natural resources market. Tommy Osborne, CKPG News.
Just as gravity always goes down, grocery prices always seem to go up, making mealtime a costly part of anyone's budget. Sam Bennison has more now on tips to keep the food bill low while still keeping high nutritional value.
And now to your health. Brought to you by Hard Drugs, Third Avenue Pharmacy, and the Phoenix Pharmacy.
It's a battle between the grocery store and your wallet, and sometimes the quality of food you get pays the price. However, armed with knowledge, you can escape the aisles, saving money with healthy food items.
People that shop with lists tend to not get influenced into those impulse buys, and they actually spend 23% less walking out of the grocery store than those people who just go in and want to be inspired.
Even the labyrinth of a grocery store layout is designed to trap you into an impulse buy. But by following your list, you might make it out unscathed.
Grocery stores are laid out in a pretty strategic way to draw consumers in and to have them spend more money. It's all psychological. So you come into a grocery store, the first thing that you see is produce, and it's bright and it's colorful, and it's meant to draw you in. You also smell the smells of the bakery, and that's also meant to draw you in. Now think about it. If you have to go just for a carton of milk, generally speaking, because grocery stores are laid out on a universal grid, you have to get to the other side of the grocery store. So you have to run the gauntlet of everything that's set up to cause you to buy more.
Sometimes buying the ingredients rather than the prepackaged food items can save you extra cash.
Think about like prepackaged salads. Those might be a good deal, right? But maybe like boiled eggs in a bag that are peeled and ready for you, things like shredded carrots or shredded cheese, things that you could DIY yourself, because as soon as you start getting a middle person involved, you're going to be spending more money at the till.
Sherry adds that a great way to plan a budget-friendly meal is through the Inflation Cookbook app.
It's an AI-generated cookbook where you punch in your region, it gives you food cost hikes and food cost drops, and it also creates recipes based on those ones that have dropped and are economically priced within your region and within your area. And so you come out with a bunch of recipes on different things you can use that are available that week.
To Your Health, brought to you by Hard Drugs, Third Avenue Pharmacy, and the Phoenix Pharmacy.
As of this morning, the lowest gas price in Prince George is sitting at $1.64.9 per liter at Costco. The lowest price in the province right now is in Quesnel at $1.62.9 per liter. Manitoba currently has the lowest fuel prices on average in the country at $1.42.4 per liter, while BC has an average price of $1.94.8 per liter.
CKPG Sports is delivered by Domino's. Try one of our delicious stuffed cheesy breads, paired up with chicken, pizza, pasta, or dessert for just $8.99 per item.
Well, it's playoff time for the Prince George Spruce Kings, at home at least. They are down 2-0 in the series, but playoff hockey is back in Prince George, and Anthony Correa got a chance to catch up with Jack Clark for an insight on tonight's big Game 3.
Game 3 tonight between the Prince George Spruce Kings and the Penticton Vs. Prince George currently trailing the series 2-0. And for more on tonight's game, I'm joined by the voice of the Prince George Spruce Kings, Jack Clark. Jack, let's start with the obvious. The Spruce Kings yet to score a goal this series, but, you know, played tight games on Game 1 and 2. What can the team kind of build on, and what can you expect for Game 3 tonight?
Yeah, I think defensively, I think the entire organization is happy with how Game 1 and 2 went. You know, this is a high-powered Penticton team. Of course, I think everybody who watches the BCHL understands what the Penticton Vs are, and they're no different this year than they have been in the past couple of years. They can put the puck in the net quickly and efficiently, but I think the Spruce Kings did a good job of making sure, you know, it didn't happen in Game 1 and Game 2. Yes, they beat us 3-0 in those first two games, but they were close games heading into the third period and deep into the third period as well. So now that we're back here at Copart Memorial Arena, I think, again, everybody who kind of follows the BCHL knows what kind of an even ice field this can be tonight.
Mm-hmm. You know, Spruce Kings getting no help. Big lineup change tonight. Charlie Zolan not starting. Maybe take me through the plan in net between the pipes for the Kings here.
Yeah, so it looks like Ryan Sanborn is going to make his first career BCHL start tonight, or playoff start tonight, I should say. Charlie Zolan, he was great in Game 1 and Game 2, I thought, especially in Game 2, dealing with a lower body injury tonight. Don't know what that means for tomorrow night Game 4, but for Game 3 tonight, he's going to be out of the lineup. Ryan Sanborn currently in the starting spot with Ryder Green serving as the backup, so we'll see what happens, who leads him out onto the ice, but it won't be Charlie Zolan.
You know, one more for you. Just quick, talk to me a little bit about keys to the game. You know, what the Spruce Kings have to do to win a crucial Game 3.
Yeah, I mean, it's easy enough, as we got to put a puck in the back of the net. You know, we've played 120 minutes of playoff hockey. They haven't beat Will Engman and Andrew Ness. It's going to be Engman again tonight. You know, he started that fable night that the Spruce Kings were up 7-0 on the Vs here at Copar Memorial Arena. So return to Copar for Will Engman, and the Spruce Kings are going to have to do a lot of what they did in that game, get him moving laterally, get quick shots away. And they'll beat him tonight.
And, you know, I see you got your playoff beard going. I got my playoff beard going. Obviously, Cougars and Spruce Kings in the playoffs. What are your thoughts on your playoff beard right now?
It's not good. I'm doing my best that I can for the boys. I've never grown a beard before. Everybody knows that I struggle with facial hair in general. I'm trying my best here. This is about, 3-4 weeks or so. So, you know, this is the farthest I've ever gotten, but it's still not good.
It's going. And, you know, Spruce Kings also growing out beards, and I had a chance to catch up with them to ask who has the best and worst playoff beard for the postseason.
Oh, best playoff beard, gonna be Babra, for sure. I'd say worst, I'm gonna go with Kaz.
Best Babs, worst, LV.
Best is gonna be Amarin Babra, and worst is probably gonna be me.
I would go with my boy, Skogan. Gonna have a best and worst? I don't want to answer that.
Oh, worst for sure, LV. Best, Kai Greaves.
Kai Greaves, best beard. I'd say worst is Vital Dennis.
Best, Killian McGregor Bennett. Worst,
Luca Primorano.
I think LV will have the best one. I think Evan Bellamy will have the worst one.
It's gotta be Lambert for sure.
Is there a sign?
Best and worst playoff beard. He's gonna grow the best beard. He's gonna grow the worst beard.
Amran Babber's gonna grow the best beard. And then worst? I don't know.
Skogan. Ty Greaves worst, definitely. I don't think that guy can grow a beard. And then I'll say Ryan Sanborn, best beard.
The TSX is up 101 points to close at 22,362. The Dow Jones is down 9 points to close at 38,884. And Artemis Gold went up 7 cents to close at $8.87.
Good evening again, everyone. We are going to see those gusty southwest winds start to ease off as we move into the evening hours. So again, tomorrow probably not as blustery as some parts of today, but certainly quite unsettled as we get into the afternoon and particularly tomorrow night. So here's our satellite looking back at the day, a mix of sun and cloud, increasing cloud. And yes, we are in for some more showers going forward. So the future cast does show tonight isn't too bad. It's fairly dry. And then into tomorrow, actually, we may have some sunshine to start, an increase in cloud though through the morning hours, and then this guy right here, that next wave of moisture hitting us really into tomorrow evening or tomorrow night, carrying into Thursday. It does strengthen into Thursday and Thursday night. Heavier rain showers will likely be for Thursday night, so more so showers to start, changing over to rain as we get into the later part of tomorrow, or into Thursday rather. Friday though is the start of a nice ridge of high pressure building, and that'll take us into the weekend. So you can see it's quite unsettled tomorrow up through Prince Rupert, inland to Terrace, some of that mixed precipitation, and then the timing for us will be tomorrow night, as we showed you on the future cast. 10 degrees in Fort St. John, expecting to see clouds with a few sunny breaks in the mix. We're leaving some sunshine in here because I think maybe we'll have the potential for some sunnier sky to start things off tomorrow, and then an increase in clouds just ahead of that next system coming through. It'll be cloudy, but much milder down through the southern part of the province, 17 in Kamloops, 15 in Kelowna, and then drier down through the south coast and inland throughout Vancouver and much of the lower mainland tomorrow. So again, this ridge really building, bringing all that nice warm air up from the south. And so we will see the impact of that come Friday and into our weekend as well. It's just in time for the weekend, so it's good news. 10 degrees, Fort St. James, clouds and showers tomorrow. Vanderhoof the same. Over towards Burns Lake, you're looking at a bit of a cooler trend, 7 degrees, not quite into those double digits for the day tomorrow. Beautiful day along the west coast, 11 in Edmonton, pretty nice actually throughout parts of Regina. Winnipeg though, expecting to see some clouds, showers, and the potential for a thunderstorm in there as well. It'll be milder into parts of the eastern half of the country, but still a little bit unsettled and quite chilly over towards St. John's. It was very rainy there today. Tomorrow, just mainly clouds and quite a foggy day for everybody along the parts of the Maritimes. So sun cloud mix later into our week, and the pleasant temperatures are coming. You'll see them here. Burns Lake, a chilly tonight, 7 tomorrow, 8 Thursday. Those are your unsettled days, and then a nice improvement from there going forward into Friday and the weekend. Mackenzie will get a bit of a break tomorrow, but then back to the showers on Wednesday night and Thursday. The potential for a morning shower is there for Friday, but your Saturday, Sunday looks pretty good. Minus 5 tonight in McBride. Still quite chilly overnight, by the way, and wind chill taking the temperature down just a little bit more. 10 degrees for the next couple of days. Not too bad. A lot of cloud cover, but really the showers are more so Friday for you. Quesnel, we'll see a few afternoon showers on Thursday, and then look at these temperatures and beautiful conditions. The overnight lows are still dipping below freezing though, even though we're going to get into a nice high pressure ridge. So for us in Prince George, we're up to 11, maybe even 12 degrees for the weekend. Yes, tomorrow we do have a little bit of sunshine potentially to start our day, increasing clouds through the afternoon, and then we're looking at showers tomorrow night into Thursday, switching over to rain Thursday night. Nice dry trend though for the weekend.
CKPG Sports is delivered by Domino's. Try one of our delicious stuffed cheesy breads paired up with chicken, pizza, pasta, or dessert for just $8.99 per item.
Well, yesterday we revealed the Prince George Cougars opponent, but now we'll take a look at the rest of the WHL to see what round two has in store. We start on the in the East, where the numbers 1, 2, 3, and 5 seeds advance to the second round quite easily. This leaves the regular season champion Saskatoon Blades to take on the Red Deer Rebels. While the other series features two former Wenatchee Wild stars battling each other in Connor Geeky and Matthew Savoy, with the Swift Current Broncos and the Moose Jaw Warriors facing off. The West was exactly the same when it came into moving on to the top three seeds and the fifth seed advancing. Cougars fans hope the battle between the Portland Winterhawks and the Everett Silvertips is a bloodbath while they focus on taking care of the Kelowna Rockets. Round two starts on Friday for every series, and it should be high-intensity, action-packed hockey. We bring you recaps and milestones in both hockey and basketball, more specifically college hoops, so make sure you pay attention in tonight's CKP3.
Starting with a repeat champion.
What an amazing run. It is a UConn coronation. The Huskies make history. Back-to-back national champions.
The UConn Huskies are your men's March Madness champion, going into the tournament as the favorite, and there was no doubt about it. Next, inching closer.
With Lars Eller taking the draw for Pittsburgh, it's fired back to Matthews. Scores! 65! He's back doping! And the Leafs have the lead!
65 for Austin Matthews, tying Alex Ovechkin's best goal-scoring season, an almost identical automatic goal from the point on the power play. This man is dangerous. Finally, Vancouver victorious.
The puck to Dakota Joshua, centers Miller, off the glove, loose puck, they score!
Connor Garland finding a loose puck and potting his second goal of the night. Milestones for both him and JT Miller, and a game winner in the second period as the Canucks defeat Vegas and take top spot in tonight's CKP3.
All right, folks, that is all for tonight. Thank you so much for joining us, as always. Your last look tonight is some of the beautiful architecture at UNBC. Have yourselves a great night. We will see you tomorrow.